Okay, George, let's do this. I have not moderated a former prime minister ever. I did moderate a prime minister from Finland with limited success. So I am going to be extremely self-effacing in this, give you a few ideas, and then let George speak for maximum 20 minutes. I will be keeping the time. And then there will be an abundant Q&A. There are already a few people who have agreed to ask difficult questions that require elaborate answers. And this is very appropriate for the man we have here with us today, who is, in a very special manner, a glocal man. He's a glocal man because he has been educated all over the world. He was born in the Midwest, in St. Paul, Minnesota, then went to Amherst College, a very famous university in rural Massachusetts, London School of Economics, where he had a master's in sociology and development, and many others that give really a very international, global outlook to this man. But why is he local? Because he belongs to a dynasty of political leaders in his native Greece. Native not because he was born there, but his family is from there. His grandfather, who had the same name, was in the government, leading the government of Greece, and so was his father, who was a professor at Berkeley. So we really have a glocal man who is at the same time global and very much local, very much a Greek dynasty. We are lucky to have you here. There is another dimension which links him to Portugal. He is now the president of the Socialist International. And as we know, the previous leader was our very own António Guterres. So here you are, a successor of Guterres, the man who could not say no, as we call him here in Portugal. And so that gives him, as I say, also an international political outlook. Very interestingly also, during his time as president of the government of Greece, as prime minister of Greece, he made a number of very important innovations, especially the bailout program and the way in which he searched for that solution. Then this idea of the referendum that in the end brought his demise is also a creative, interesting idea. And now he has founded a new party. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir, a new party. And who knows? The scene in Greece is so complex that this new party can become an instrument for him. But I want to just leave you with one site on the internet where you can have all this information that I find particularly attractive, especially because he didn't know about it. There is a site on the internet called Brainy Quotes from George Papandreou. Some very famous sentences that he mentioned, I can give you four here. The Marshall Plan was after the destruction, and we are very grateful to the US, but now we should do it to ourselves. First quote. Then this very famous one that corruption corruption permeates our country. In our country, people don't pay taxes. This one touches me particularly. And so I'm going to read it out loud. If we, the Greeks, were the problem, it would be very convenient. But what would happen to Spain, Portugal, Italy, the whole Eurozone? So the idea that there is somehow a Greek threat to the whole Eurozone. He says, he concludes the brainy quote saying, we need more cooperation, less simplification and prejudice. And the last, which is an optimistic one, Greece can be a case study on how to strengthen coordination on fiscal policy. Yes, sirree, it can. Thank you, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much, Georges, for that splendid introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, I had the unlucky privilege of being the first prime minister in the Eurozone to need an adjustment program and a bailout from near bankruptcy. And of course, we worked together in the European Union to create this mechanism from scratch. When we initiated the program, I called it an odyssey, a difficult journey of sacrifices and challenges with storms and demons on our road. But at the end, we would reach Ithaca. Today, many Greeks will tell you that this is no odyssey. It is the punishment of Sisyphus. Now, Sisyphus was doomed by the gods to push a rock up the mountain again and again, only to see it roll back down the other side every time he reached the top. So let me begin by congratulating Portugal on its successful arrival to Ithaca and exit from the adjustment program, its access to the sovereign bond markets on very favorable terms. But let me begin with Greece. I was shocked when I became prime minister to discover a deficit that was not 6% as had been reported by the government, the previous government, but finally amounted to 15.7% of GDP. That's why beyond our budget and current account deficit, the most damaging to our economy was the deficit in trust, in credibility. The statistics fraud was only an example of institutional deficit of our economy. So while we faced a rigid labor and products market, a pension system that was overstretched, a bloated number of employees in the public sector, these were only symptoms of institutional failure. Bad governance, lack of transparency, corruption, crony capitalism, a highly centralized bureaucracy, capture of politics by vested interests, and clientelism. These were the deeper issues. In comparing Greece to Portugal, a recent study points out the highly clientelistic nature of Greek politics. And this also undermined consensus building during the crisis, while you, in Portugal and Ireland, were able to achieve much wider political consensus, which helped you overcome the crisis more effectively. So Greece needed deep institutional reform, putting all government expenditures online, consolidating 55 regions to 6,000 local government entities to 2,000, 5 levels of government to 3, an independent statistical service, meritocracy in the public sector, even at the top level. These were just some of the first steps I took. But let me give you an example as to why this was important fiscally. We knew there was corruption in the medical sector, doctors overprescribing and getting kickbacks from multinational pharmaceutical companies. We pushed a simple reform. All prescriptions of doctors contracted with the public sector, the public pension system, would be done online. Despite huge opposition, I said we will sever any doctor's contract if he or she does not comply. 95% complied. We now have savings of 50%, approximately 2.5 billion euros a year, more than what we collect from the total of property taxes today. I often say that when we joined the Union after the dictatorship, without being asked to revamp our state apparatus, we lost the opportunity to become a much more transparent governance system. And the Brookings Institute study says that if we were as transparent as Sweden, for example, we would gain 8% of GDP. Gerhard Schröder has often told me he could never have done both austerity and reform at the same time in Germany. Yet the adjustment program prioritized austerity. Actually, the symptoms, that's what they were, and they were not the underlying problems. An example of this is that Greece has a large non-tradable sector compared with its tradable sector and compared with Portugal. So internal devaluation, cuts in wages, for example, did little to boost exports, as it may have done in Portugal, although that might be disputed even here in your country. So reforming, restructuring our economy and our institutions of governance were the needed priorities, a functioning, transparent democracy. But these types of reforms take time, and that would mean slower fiscal consolidation. So So I come to some of the Eurozone problems. That would also have meant more money for the program, which was very difficult for member states to give in the Eurozone. An alternative would have been a Eurobond or some form of guarantee from Europe, which was ruled out by a number of countries and particularly by Germany. But that brings me to another important point. Pooling risk was seen as anathema, negative, Eurobonds or banking unions. But in the end, this also meant we were not pooling our strengths as a European project, not using our full capacity. Actually, this was a very convenient narrative. If the prescription was that Greece is the problem, well, all we had to do was put our house in order and everything would be fine. However, we overlooked the systemic problems of the Eurozone. And they were things like an imbalance between a single currency, but multiple diverging sovereign debt markets. We have the surplus countries and the deficit countries. We have our internal devaluation, which was quickly lost when the euro would appreciate. Our inadequate stress testing of our banks, tax competition, the lack of a banking union, so that some people felt that if you had your euros in Greece or Italy or in Portugal, maybe they weren't safe. Maybe you had to put them somewhere else. And of course, the discussion about Brexit, which destroyed any economic activity, because why would you invest? Why would you borrow? Why would you consume if you were going to change your currency? So it might have been convenient for many core countries to say Greece was the problem, but in the end, the market saw that it wasn't just Greece. These were structural issues of the wider Eurozone. And the markets then started to fear what was going to happen, because they saw Greece as a test case. If they don't support Greece, if Greece is not supported, well, maybe other countries will not be supported either. And that created contagion rather than containment. And that continued until 2012, when we had almost a collapse of the euro, but then we had Mario Draghi coming out and saying, "I will do whatever it takes to save the euro." What was that? That was a show of force of the collective Europe. And immediately the markets reacted positively by the spreads going down, and Spain and Italy did not need to access the ESM. Maybe Portugal would not have needed to be part of the ESM if that had been done earlier. Maybe we would not have to have a bailout if the ECB had said that in 2010. But what it does show is that if we work collectively, if we pool our strengths as Europe, we can deal with these types of crises, whether it's financial, but I also believe other types of crises around the world. And that is the strength of Europe. But one more other point, I think, which we got wrong in the Eurozone. What did the US, what did China do after the 2008 crisis? A stimulus program in the US, a QE, QE program, quantitative easing. We are only now beginning quantitative easing after 7 years. We had a short stimulus program at the national level, but nothing at the European level. And then we went into austerity and recession. Well, let me come to Greece and what we have achieved and what maybe conclusions we could bring on the on this issue. Greece has had the fastest fiscal adjustment of any nation in the OECD. We are number one in reforms amongst OECD countries, although we started very far behind and we have not been very good in implementing many of the laws. However, if we have achieved that, the consequences have also been very difficult. We have lost 25% of GDP. Youth unemployment is close to 50%. Cuts and heavy taxes on the middle class. There's also a feeling of lack of ownership of this program, and that's when I called for a referendum in 2011, and I was criticized that I would make the markets go crazy when I really wanted to get the trust of our citizens. So there was a political backlash, an anti-austerity vote in the recent elections, partially anti-European. However, we were very close not only to have the primary surplus, but to access the markets. Now, with this political change, we are in fear of a possible default without knowing what the consequences would mean. Again, the issue of Brexit has been discussed, but that would be a catastrophe for our economy and for the average Greek. But markets seem to have factored in this possibility. However, a bitter divorce in the European Union and the Eurozone will have long-term consequences. And of course, Greece is also still a stable point in a very volatile region of the Balkans, the Middle East, Syria, Turkey, Ukraine, and the Black Sea. So what is Greece now demanding? It wants new terms for an extension of the adjustment program. But on the other hand, countries like Portugal, but not only, do not feel there should be special treatment for Greece, creating a moral hazard or a double standard. Yet we need to find a compromise. And if Greece is a success story, it will be a success story for the whole of Europe. So let's look at the underlying problems rather than getting caught into the details of the existing program. I believe there is a compromise if we emphasize what I thought we needed in the very beginning, deeper reforms in Greece, and reforms to create a sustainable economy and transparent functioning democracy. These should take priority over further fiscal measures, cuts and taxes. More flexibility on the need for high primary surplus. Also, some favorable decisions from EU institutions to address the debt overhang or issue, so that we will eventually be able to access the markets. But this also points to wider issues in the European Union. Will Greece be a precedent for other countries, such as Portugal? Well, I believe in the Eurozone, we do need deeper and further integration. As this occurs, and I hope it does, this should also lead to the mutualization of debt in the Eurozone. That may mean further transfer of sovereign power, but it also will mean solutions to the debt problem in the periphery. It will also give the periphery space for further reforms, but investment and restructuring in our productive capacity. So my point is a simple one. The crisis will not simply of some peripheral countries, but also a crisis in the Eurozone. Now, of course, beyond the Eurozone, we are also facing global issues. And I believe Europe needs to be a major player in humanizing globalization, because in the end, we were attacked, or we were victims of a financial crisis at the global level. We were victims of rating agencies that had sold us AAA bonds that were fraudulent, but then became over-strict when we were then having the sovereign debt crisis. I remember passing a very difficult austerity package in the parliament and trying to get as big a consensus I could, and everybody thanked Greece and said it's a very good program. But the next day, rating agencies downgraded Greece. Why? Because they said there is a political risk. So they had more power than actually our democratic institutions. One of Greece's problems, of course, was tax evasion, but that's not only a question of our institutions. The global financial system is full of incentives for tax evasion through tax havens, offshore companies, tax competition, tax inversion, robbing our own coffers and our own state of resources which are very important and creating huge inequalities in our societies. And while we were forced to hike taxes to cut the deficit, this also stymied, it hurt growth in key sectors. I know here in Portugal that tourism has been hit because of the need for higher taxes, losing competitiveness. We in Greece fought to keep taxes low even during the program, and in many ways, and we're still fighting for that, to save the tourist industry. But there's another issue. We are in a globalizing, digitized economy. This also has a major impact on our developed world. There's jobless growth, part-time work. Two-thirds of the workforce seems to be in part-time work. Automation, jobs going to cheaper continents. How can we compete? We are often competing with countries that have no collective bargaining, no labor standards, no environmental standards, few, if any, social security systems, even a lack of human rights. This gives them a temporary comparative advantage. But is this the model we want to emulate? Are we going to continue the race to the bottom as an alternative? Is there an alternative? Well, I think Europe underestimates its capacity, and the European peace project is of great importance, even more importance today, but it must be expanded to become a humanizing project for globalizing economy. But to do so, we need to strengthen our institutions and integrate further. And that, of course, is very difficult when we have the growth of Euroscepticism, return to nationalism, stereotyping, even racism, growing in Europe. But maybe if we can think of how we democratize our European institutions, we can give a sense of power to our citizens. Well, what I'm saying is rather than our competitiveness based on the race to the bottom, which in the end heightens inequality, let's compete by investing in quality. Even at the national level, when countries like Portugal, Greece, or Spain are strapped for cash, we could have the European Union invest and stimulate the economy. And why not be a global leader in what I believe is a major challenge for the world, which is sustainable and green development? This is where I see the future of a competitive European economy. Invest in a green economy by creating the infrastructure for energy grids, communication and transportation infrastructure linking East and West, North and Southern Europe. Invest in research and development, education for the future of a sustainable green economy. Expand Jean-Claude Juncker's strategic investment program, but also direct it to the countries which are recently hit by the crisis, such as Greece or Portugal, by investing in our comparative advantages, and in particular, in quality products, rather than trying to compete on the basis of low wages. We need to further pool our strengths and integrate further the banking union, Eurobonds, or project Eurobonds. Europe needs to be a force in the world, and I say we need to be a force of humanizing the global economy. Today, many of our citizens see Europe as the opposite. They see Europe as imposing the negative aspects, the negative imperatives of the global markets. So Europe should not only ask our citizens to adjust, Europe should help our citizens to be able to be strong, to be empowered, so that we actually mitigate crisis, we can deal with the crisis in a more humane way, in a more democratic way, in a more effective way where we bring in our citizens. But even more important, Europe should actually lead the world rather than follow the imperatives of globalization. We should fight for our standards, for our values in this globalizing economy. We should fight for a race to the top and not a race to the bottom. If Europe is to be a force in the world, we need to further integrate. Further integration, of course, many people fear this would be more power to Brussels or more power to some directorate. That's why integration must also be accompanied by a deepening of the democratic processes in the European Union. For example, I have been a proponent of electing a president of the Commission by our citizens rather than behind closed doors. So I think the challenge for Europe is to go beyond this crisis where we are fighting with each other, where we are very introverted, where we are calling each other names, where we are going back to nationalism, and rekindle the spirit of a common European Union and our values by pooling our strengths, by pooling our efforts, and by moving at the global level by humanizing globalization. Otherwise, we will see a globalizing economy splintering our union and dehumanizing our societies. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This is the moderation that one loves, when one does not need to moderate, because the speaker speaks for 18 minutes. And I was debating, am I going to interrupt him now? That will look rude. But at the same time, I said I would interrupt at 15. Perfect. Allow me to congratulate you on your precision.